This episode was brought to you by Brilliant.
Hello, cadets. Welcome back to another great episode. Have you ever asked yourself if blockchains are useless? There has been article after article listing reasons why blockchain is useless. I'm here to help you make a decision as to whether it's true or if it's a huge misunderstanding. We're going to take the 9 main reasons why people think blockchain is useless and explain why each problem is wrong. I'm sure there are many more problems out there with blockchain, but we're just going to break down the 9 main issues today. Just one thing to keep in mind. Because cryptocurrencies are built on top of blockchain technology, we're going to group them together for the purpose of this video. If you want more information about what blockchain is, check out this video here. Let's get to it. I'm Captain Crypto, and welcome to Cryptonauts. We've listed the reasons and timestamps below in the description, so feel free to jump to what you're interested in hearing about. So let's start with problem number 1. Crypto is a scam, specifically ICOs. According to Noriel Rubini, chairman at Rubini Global Economics and NYU Stern School of Business, he is quoted as saying, "It's a scam. The whole ICO industry is a scam. People are robbing, raising funds for projects with zero value." That may have been true in 2017, with 92% of all ICO projects never coming to market. However, these days, most projects are moving away from that model and are embracing real projects accomplishing real results. One successful blockchain project is Basic Attention Token, or BAT, where you get paid for watching ads on its Brave browser. With over 20 million users, Brave browser has now captured about 0.05% of browser market share, and it's still growing. Overall, blockchain's total market cap has increased to over $2 trillion in just 11 years. If it's all a scam, then it's a very profitable one. Problem number 2. Blockchain is not scalable. Over the last 10 years, all sorts of scalability solutions have been discussed. Yet the number of transactions per second that can be done with Bitcoin versus the traditional technology such as Visa or MasterCard is simply not comparable. While it's true that Bitcoin may be permanently stuck to just approving 5 transactions every second, there are many projects out there solving the issue of scalability. Ethereum has ETH 2.0 that will be moving to sharding, a method that creates mini blockchains to speed up transaction approval. Other projects are utilizing similar sharding solutions like Polkadot with parachains and Cardano with sidechains. There are even innovative solutions like IOTA using a DAG, which is a fancy way of saying blockchain, where one transaction approves 2 other transactions, making it exponentially scalable. So currently, the scalability is a problem compared to other current payment systems like Visa with 1,700 transactions a second. So while blockchain transactions per second may be slow now, it should speed up tremendously within the next 5 years. Problem number 3. Bitcoin is bad for the environment. Carrying out a payment with Visa requires about 0.002 kilowatt hours. The same payment with Bitcoin uses up 906 kilowatt hours, more than 500,000 times as much, and enough to power a 2-person household for about 3 months. Yes, it's true. Bitcoin is bad for the environment, with miners around the world running mining equipment 24/7, 365. However, according to this 2019 University of Cambridge report, close to 60% of all mining operations are from renewable energy, so most of the energy produced doesn't really have an environmental impact. Also, as mentioned before, most blockchain and cryptocurrencies are moving away from proof of work to proof of stake. If you'd like to know more about the differences between them, check out our proof of work versus proof of stake video, link up here. But the main difference is that proof of stake has low impact on the environment and requires only a fraction of energy that proof of work does. Problem number 4. Blockchain technology is often centralized. The correspondent says, "Moreover, in any distributed trust system, there are backdoor methods for centralization to creep back in. With Bitcoin, there are only a few miners of consequence. There's one company that provides most of the mining hardware. There are only a few dominant exchanges. To the extent that most people interact with Bitcoin, it is through these centralized systems. This also allows for attacks against blockchain-based systems." This is all true, and people in the blockchain space recognize this. That's why there has been a continuous push toward decentralized systems. For example, moving from proof of work to proof of stake, where mining hardware is no longer relevant. There's also a giant move towards decentralized exchanges like Uniswap, having its usage grow 132% in 2020 alone. With Uniswap, a transaction is automatically completed through a crypto wallet like MetaMask, and you don't have to interact with anyone to complete the transaction. Problem number 5, blockchain is for bad people. By the correspondent again, honestly, cryptocurrencies are useless. They're only used by speculators looking for quick riches, people who don't like government-backed currencies, and criminals who want a black market way to exchange money. While it's true that there have been nefarious online drug markets like Silk Road, where Bitcoin thrived, cryptocurrencies and blockchains will have more of an impact with developing countries as a whole. One project looking to move African countries away from inflationary national currencies is Akon, a project by the famous singer Akon.
Yes, this Akon.
Their goal is to make an African country run their entire economy with cryptocurrencies. For more details, check out this video link right here. You also have to look at all of the new investments being made into Bitcoin by old Wall Street firms. Millions and millions of dollars are going into Bitcoin from investment firms that would not be investing if they believe A, it was for criminals only, or B, if it was for quick riches. They're investing because they see the long-term value of Bitcoin. Even Goldman Sachs is looking into digital asset custody regarding Bitcoin. According to this article, the Goldman Insider said the bank's digital assets initiative was part of a broad digital strategy. So they're starting off with Bitcoin, but it definitely won't be the last cryptocurrency they adopt. Problem number 6, blockchain projects don't deliver. Most blockchain projects don't make it past a press release, an inventory by Bloomberg showed. The Honduran Land Registry was going to use blockchain. That plan has been shelved. The NASDAQ was going to do something with blockchain. Not happening. The Dutch Central Bank then? Nope. Out of over 86,000 blockchain projects that have been launched, 92% have been abandoned by the end of 2017, according to consultancy firm Deloitte. Building a proper blockchain is hard, and sometimes building a blockchain is not necessarily the best solution for a problem. According to this research paper aptly titled, "Do You Need a Blockchain?" they state, "In general, using an open or permissioned blockchain only makes sense when multiple, mutually mistrusting entities want to interact and change the state of a system, and are not willing to agree on an online trusted third party." It's like this Spider-Man pointing meme, where you don't trust who you're talking to and interacting with. A blockchain is a good idea. But outside of that, a centralized database may be enough. The paper specifically mentions how blockchain is not great for supply chain management and land title registry because the truth can easily be manipulated or not enforced. The research paper even provides a decision chart to help you decide if you need a blockchain. Regarding a 92% failure rate, it's only slightly higher than the failure rate of startups. According to an infographic by Failery, 9 out of 10 startups fail, many of them within 10 years. So it's not out of the ordinary for 92% of all blockchain projects to fail. In the end, people were trying to use a blockchain solution for a non-blockchain problem, and you can't force a solution if it's not designed for it. Problem number 7, blockchains are not immutable. There are many highly publicized instances of blockchains being altered. Bitcoin was forked multiple times, including in 2010 when an integer overflow error in the software led to the creation of 92 billion bitcoins and the entire network had to roll back the ledger. Ethereum was forked after a massive hack in 2016. Furthermore, due to Europe's General Data Protection Regulation, which comes into effect in May, and says users may have control over their data, developers are now exploring ways to delete data from blockchains. One of the main selling points of blockchains is that it's really hard to manipulate. You would need to spend a lot of energy and money to do so. However, there are some mistakes or issues so big, they call for a giant rollback or fork into an upgraded path. So, what are blockchain developers doing about this possible issue? First, blockchain developers have built a little cottage industry on blockchain audits. An audit checks for vulnerabilities and security holes to prevent bad actors from abusing a faulty blockchain. Second, most blockchains are open sourced, so problems can be found quickly as they're being developed. Last, some blockchain projects have set up governing bodies to make significant decisions on the progress and direction of a project's development. As an example, Polkadot has a governing body of 6 to 24 people at all times, and they change every few weeks. Their definition of a governing body is a formalized system that is encoded on-chain, ensures that these rules are followed and actors are accountable. Their voting is based on stake-weighted voting, meaning decisions pass or fail on a stake-weighted majority. In the end, no blockchain wants huge dilemmas to appear, especially the creators or custodians of the project. Problem number 8, blockchains are irreversible. If your Bitcoin exchange gets hacked, you lose all of your money. If your Bitcoin wallet gets hacked, you lose all of your money. If you forget your login credentials, you lose all of your money. If there's a bug in the code of your smart contract, you lose all of your money. If someone successfully hacks the blockchain security, you lose all of your money. In many ways, trusting technology is harder than trusting people. Once something is in the blockchain, it cannot be removed. For instance, hundreds of links to child abuse material and revenge porn were placed in the Bitcoin blockchain by malicious users. It's impossible to remove those. This is a serious problem that may be hindering blockchain's mass adoption. So what are developers doing to solve this issue? Blockchain developers have made social recovery wallets. They are like regular wallets that allow you to reset your signing key if you lose it. The innovative way to reset it is using guardians. Guardians are a third-party member that allow you to reset your signing key if you've lost it. So guardians can be other devices, friends or family, and institutions that allow you to reset your signing key. So if you lost your signing key, the user can simply reach out to their guardians and ask them to sign a special transaction to change the signing pub key registered in the wallet contract to a new one. This is easy. They can simply go to a webpage such as security.loopring.io, sign in, see a recovery request, and sign in. About as easy for each guardian as making a Uniswap trade. This was spoken by Vitalik. There are already existing social recovery wallets out there like the Argent and Loopring wallet. When it comes to other things like reversing transactions, I don't think we're there yet. However, smart people are constantly trying to improve blockchain tech, and this is one great example of it happening. Problem number 9, blockchain is not self-regulating. As Bloomberg columnist Matt Levine wrote, "My immutable, unforgeable, cryptographically secure blockchain record proving that I have 10,000 pounds of aluminum in a warehouse is not much use to a bank if I then smuggle the aluminum out the warehouse through the back door. Data should reflect reality, but sometimes reality changes and the data stays the same. That's why we have notaries, supervisors, lawyers, actually all those boring people that blockchain thinks it can do without." So to put the problem in another way, the blockchain is just a dumb data sheet and it doesn't self-correct if there's a discrepancy when it comes to real-world objects. Well, currently some blockchain projects are implementing self-correcting mechanisms with something called an oracle. When it comes to trading on Uniswap, they have built a powerful oracle that makes it hard for bad actors to manipulate prices on the decentralized market. Oracles can also be based on consensus by people. For example, Augur is a prediction market and it uses people voting for the truth of an outcome. Betting on an outcome uses the rep token, and if a person bets on the wrong outcome, they lose their rep. Lastly, and this is just personal speculation, within 20 years from now, everything will have a microchip and everything will be tracked. This means that the digital space and the real space will be interconnected. Items you use every day in your house, like your phone, speakers, light bulbs, and security cams, are connected to your Wi-Fi. It's not crazy to think that in 20 years that your smart shoes will have microchips to keep track of your steps, your smart belt will tell you to lose a few pounds, and your smart toilet will automatically order those fiber pills that you've been desperately needing these past few months. Fiber pills. In the end, like anything technology related, blockchains are dumb and useless if no one is using them. Like the people that built them, they are ever evolving, and if there's one thing to take away from this video, it's this. Blockchain is not perfect. It is still really early, it's still evolving, and will only get better over time. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. We spend a lot of time researching and writing these longer episodes, so if you can give us a like or subscribe, that would really help us out.
Do you know what's the fastest way to learn? Or the fastest language to speak? Or how about finding a counterfeit coin? In everyday life, we deal with a lot of uncertainty. Brilliant has a great course that gives you the tools for managing uncertainty and interpreting information. You will learn cutting-edge mathematics like information theory, Bayesian networks, and causal inference. Basically, get really good at solving puzzles and making calculations about things you don't know. Check out the Knowledge and Uncertainty course at Brilliant. If you want to sign up for free, use our link below. Go to brilliant.org/cryptonauts. Oh, and also, the first 200 people that go to that link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription.
Remember to HODL, secure crypto, and may Satoshi and Vitalik be with you always.